Out of Kinshuk has a very unique experience in 1987 that no one else has had, that Baba adopted him as his son in December of 1987. He became an Acharya in the same month of December 1987. And then quickly after that, he was trained in Vishesh Yoga in 1988 and in Microvita Sadhana soon later in 1988. He was appointed by Baba as a member of the Proto Board in 1988 and continued through 1995. He also began research at that time on Baba's medicines as prescribed in Baba's book, Natural Remedies, which Dada Jyoti Rishananda mentioned yesterday. And Dada Kinshuk's work continues today with the Microvita medicines. He was chosen as president and Proto Pramukh of the United Administration in Calcutta in March of 2010. He recently shared the president role with Dada Bhavesh Ananda, but he's continuing as the Proto Pramukh at this time. And we're very fortunate, and I'm very happy that he's here to join us today. And Dada Kinshuk, please share your presentation. Thank you very much. You can start now, Dada.
Thank you. Thank you very much. See, this topic, Tantra, is a big topic, and it need few days time to cover the topic. But I've chosen the silent part of this Tantra, what Baba gave, and touched those part and came to a final conclusion based on that one. So you can see here, Tantra can be defined as the liberation from bondage. Bondages of dullness and staticity that you all know that in our life there is dullness and staticity, and Tantra, what it does, it liberates us. It can also be defined as the process of transforming latent divinity into supreme divinity, also known as Tantra Sadhana. This is the process. Now, what is that process? So it will come later on. What is the mean by the process? The process is nothing but the spiritual practice. It is a practice, and it is a practical thing, not a theoretical. Spiritual practice is the key to liberate and aspirant from dullness and animality. Only that spiritual practice can liberate us from dullness. What definition we have given, liberation for dullness and animality, that Tantra only does that one. This helps in expanding the experience of spiritual self. Spiritual practice forms the basis of Tantra. It can be rightly, Tantra is nothing but sadhana or spiritual practice. And without Tantra, without sadhana, there can't be Tantra. Cult of Tantra is neither a religion nor a idiom. It is a form of spiritual chant. Tantra is all about the expansion of mind. There is no consideration of caste, creed, as there is in so-called religion. This aspect of religion makes a person narrow-minded and is against the spirit of Tantra, the so-called religion. Why spiritual practice of sadhana is the essential part of Tantra? In this world, every action is associated with vibration. And where there is vibration, there is sound. Acoustic implication is there. The fundamental sound that works behind an action is known as seed of action. In Sanskrit, it refers to Bija Mantra, acoustic root or seed sound. In the world, we experience contraction or dullness. Everything is accompanied by a vibration sound. The Bija Mantra or seed sound of dullness is Ta. And sadhana that liberates spiritual experience from the influence of Ta is Tantra. In every living entity, there is spiritual power dormant in them. It is fact, everybody knows that this spiritual force is dormant in us. And this practice of sadhana, that is Tantra sadhana, not that a religion or religion, helps us to awaken this spiritual force and expand it and unify it with the supreme divinity. Lowermost portion of spiritual port is known as Kula. It is the abode of Sambhu, called Sambhulinga, not Sambhulinga, Sambhulinga. The unconscious animality reside in the Kula. that in the lowest part of the our vertebral column, in a coil form, 3.5 times, is nothing but a latent divine force. The supreme divine force is known as Kula Kundalini, which resides in the Muladhara Chakra, wrapped around the Swayambhu Linga. It can also be referred as the coil serpentine. So, awaken the Kula Kundalini from her long hibernation, it is liberation wrongly written, long hibernation with the help of proper wave generated from a proper mantra received from great specialist, Sadguru or Tantric personality or Tarak Brahma in the form of Guru. This is the first stage of the process, the sadhana. And the second stage, the awakened Kula Kundalini must be pushed upward in the second stage. Now you have awakened it from his hibernation. Now you have to push it from the Muladhara Chakra to the through all the chakra to the Sahasrara Chakra. A third stage, existence of Kula Kundalini must be suspended in the non-attributant sign, existence of Shiva, Supreme Consciousness, or Nirguna Brahma, Param Shiva. This is the ideal of Tantra. This Param Shiva is in the Sahasrara Chakra. The Param Shiva is in the Sahasrara Chakra. The Sahasrara Chakra is the controller of all the glands and is the central station of all the waves and mantras. The human staticity can be controlled into spirituality or divinity only after arriving at the Sahasrara Chakra. The Kula Kundalini rises from the Muladhara Chakra, height of crudeness or animality. Finally, the spiritual aspirant suspends oneself in Parama Shiva at the Sahasrara Chakra, whose rank is beyond the scope of all strict and seed sound. In the process of in this process, the passage, bondage, all mental weakness, and conquering mental repute, enemies, and finally transform oneself from animality into divinity. This is a great fight. Term is sadhana samara. Sadhana samara means fight. The sadhana is nothing but a fight against all these things. The internal enemy and the external enemy. The main character of Tantra is fight. It repels human vigor, tactless fight. A path devoid of fight is nothing, is not a path of sadhana. During the fight, crude ideas are replaced by the subtle ideas. Tantra sadhana is all-round fight, both external and internal, what I said earlier. Internal fight, what is internal fight? The internal fight is practice of raging Kula Kundalini. One has to erode and take up his or her Kula Kundalini against one's crude thought with all the strength of one's intuition. And what is external fight? Shattering the boundaries of hatred, suspicion, fear, shyness, etc. by direct action. One has to apply vigorous force or control over his or her worldly conduct and expression. So this is the internal and external fight which we go through when we learn the sadhana. Tantra does not recognize any racial or geological, political or national or economical differences among human beings, but it does give recognition to individual vigor. Tantra is sadhana for everybody in the society. Ceremonial sacrifices, prayers, and other extroversial rituals are neither tantra nor sadhana. Every sadhana that aims at the attainment of supreme, irrespective of its religion affiliation, is definitely santantra. Tantra is not a religion, it is a science of sadhana. Tantra is practical science and not a theoretical. We learn the theoretical side to understand the sadhana only. But the main thing is that we have to practice it. And practically we have to do that. That is sadhana. The practical process of tantra begins with the physical asana, yamniyama, progress to physico-psychic, that is pranayama, then psychic, that we do in Ishwar Panidhan, then to psycho-spiritual dharana, dhyan, then ultimately result in supreme spiritual stance, samadhi. That evolution, creation, how it was started, the tantric explanation. There are also other explanations. In science, there are explanations, the powder down of matter and like this. And this tantric explanation is something else. Our standing and culminating point is the same. The point where we start, ultimately we have to merge in that point again. In the initial stage, when there is no creation, Purusha and Prakriti are in balance state. When Prakriti loses are balanced, different evolution changes begins. Prakriti and her principle are given different name at different stage of evolution, changing in the flow of creation. There is no imbalance in the triangle of force, sentient, mutative, static of Prakriti, first stage. Here Prakriti is called Kasuki Shakti or Shivani Shakti. As she is responsible for creation of Koshas, therefore she has been given this name, Kosaki Shakti. That she is responsible creation of Koshas, layer of mind, and she is given this name. In the supreme stage, Kosaki remains unmanifested, and the primordial cause of all subsequent manifestation is in Kosaki Shakti. This triangular of force of Prakriti loses its equilibrium in the second stage. Here, Prakriti is first expressed as a straight line emerging from one of the vertices of unbalanced triangle. It is called Bhairavi Shakti or intermediate state. So first is Kosaki Shakti, then the expression occurs in a straight line, that is Bhairavi Shakti. Here, a straight line means there is no vibration. Here, there is no wave. Hence, creation remains beyond the scope of perception. Where there is no any vibration, there is no creation. It is called the nada state, or the flow without curvature in a straight line. This is nada state. Then let us come to a third state. First Kosaki, then the Bhairavi Shakti or nada attains the form of kala. She is called the Bhavani Shakti now. So Kosaki, Bhairavi, and Bhavani. Kala means expression with curvature. And now all this, whatever we see in this world, that creation is started. Bhavani Shakti is active in air, light, vital energy, and numerous other entities, and is responsible for maintaining, coordinating link between crude and subtle. Now, Tantra means sadhana or intuition effects here. Here the process is reversed. Now, when we do sadhana, we have seen that Kosaki Shakti, then Bhairavi Shakti, then Bhavani Shakti. But when we do sadhana, then devotees elevate themselves from Bhavani Shakti to Bhairavi Shakti, then to Kosaki Shakti, and finally attain oneness with the supreme entity. Devotee need to ideate on Purushottama or supreme consciousness. Creation of stage of sadhana is continued. By such ideation, Bhavani will be transformed into Bhairavi and Bhairavi into Kosaki, thereby establishing oneself between the devotee and oneness between the devotee and the Lord. This journey is from crude to subtle. Here, devotee need two things. Shraddha, implicit veneration for one's goal, love for the goal, and virya, that is stamina. These two things are most important in this whole journey. This is obtained by regular spiritual practice. The more the influence of Bhavani Shakti, the greater the feeling of differentiation in this world. And the more the influence of Bhairavi Shakti, the greater the feeling of unity. So our sadhana is from Bhairavi, Bhavani Shakti to Bhairavi, and from Bhairavi to Kosaki. And when one's cognitive faculty becomes so subtle that one sees Brahma in all the manifested entity, that great entity in all the manifested entity, one can play a proper role in the practical world. One must realize that we all are brothers and sisters belonging to the same family. That happens when our mind is shifted from Bhavani Shakti to Bhairavi Shakti, and then goes to this Kosaki Shakti, then you see oneness in this whole creation. Stage of Sadhana, by constant superimposition of cosmic ideation, this Bhavani Shakti is transported into Bhairavi Shakti. When this happens, all the objects of the world are seen as the expression of that great entity, Brahma. Second stage, as Sadhana advances, one realizes that everything is Brahma. But I and he remains. But at the second stage, still there is a feeling of I and he. He means that the great entity, that unit and cosmic entity, that differences remains. In the third stage, doer and the deed and the witnessing entity merge in the same consciousness. One undifferentiated supreme entity remains. We have to become the master of all the Shakti, the cosmic in the process of sadhana. The cosmic force that is active in the psychic sphere of an individual is Bhairavi Shakti. This Bhairavi is the force which starts moving from the vertex of unbalanced supreme triangle in a straight line. The vertex of triangle is a point. One will have to concentrate one's mind on a particular point in the process of sadhana. This we do in our asana shuddhi. We come to a point and concentrate there. And this Bhairavi Shakti is concentrated at a nucleus point and subsequently transformed into Kosaki Shakti. When transformation occurs, unit mind gradually dissolves into cosmic mind. Finally, by sadhana and grace of Guru, we have to defeat this Kosaki Shakti at the hand of Purusha, the cognitive entity. One has to become master of Bhavani, Bhairavi, and Kosaki Shakti. This is the process of sadhana. One has to become master of all these three Shakti, three energy. Once this is attained, one attains enormous power to subdue the wicked forces and protect the forces of righteousness in the external world and also in the internal world. So the real leadership lies in the hand of tantricas. The merger takes place of the unit I into supreme consciousness. This is complete salvation or moksha. If the unit I expand and become cosmic I, it is liberation or mukti. Human being really want liberation of permanent nature, and that is salvation, moksha. Now, later deeper into understanding how sadhana helps in merger of unit I into cosmic entity. The sadhana which enables this is called Ashtanga Yoga Sadhana, Eightfold Sadhana. We all know the aggregate of seven lokas is Brahma, and unit entity or jiva is included in the five koshas, that is unit mind. Seven lokas are formed by the different combination of the static, mutative, and sentient principle of Prakriti. So mathematically, if you speak, there can be only six combination of three different things. It can be represented as factorial three, or mathematically that is factorial three. Factorial three means 3 × 2 × 1, that is 6. So these six combination can be as follows. You see here sentient, mutative, and statics are there. So if you start from last one, you see static is, this is maximum 3+, then medium is 2+, and small is 1+. So maximum here, static is maximum, then medium is mutative, and sentient is only 1+. Then in the second stage, this sentient is 3+, mutative is only 1+, small, and this is medium. Then we go to third one. Here mutative is 3+, then static is 2+, and sentient is only 1+. Here sentient should be 2+. Sorry. This is mutative 3+, this is 2+, and this is 1+. Then again here mutative 3+, then static, then here this sentience should be 1+, and static should be 2+. Yeah, and then we go to next one, where sentience is 3+, mutative is 1+, and static is 2+. Then sentience is 3+, mutative is 2+, and static is 1+. So, here only in these two we have to change something. Here mutative is 3+, then sentience will be 2+, and static will be 1+. And here 3+, and then sentient will be 1+, So these are 6 combinations. So if you consider that there are 7 lokas, so we start from last one. This is Bhuval Lok, then Bhuval Lok, then Swar Lok, then Mahal Lok, then Jana Lok, then Tapal Lok. These are 6 lok we are seeing here. But there are 7 lok. Where is the 7th one? Then where is the 7th? All these attributes of Prakriti are there, but in the dormant of balance is there, the 7th kosar. This loka is called Satya Loka or Brahma Loka, where Brahma is in Nirguna state, non-attributional state. Unit of Jiva need a physical body to support the base. This base is called Annamaya Kosha, formed from Bhuloka. Annamaya means formed from food. So our body is formed from food. And Kamamaya Kosha, because you see our mind is formed from these 5 koshas. So Kamamaya Kosha is formed from Bhuval Lok, then Manamaya Kosha from Swar Lok, and Atimanas Kosha from Mahal Lok, and Vigyanamaya Kosha from Jana Lok, and Hiranmaya Kosha from Tapal Lok. So these are all the 5 koshas which form our unit mind and cosmic mind that is a combination of 7 lokas. And the non-attribution entity where we have to go for the complete liberation, that is in Satya Loka. How this merger into Supreme Consciousness by sadhana take place? Unit mind is formed from Kamamaya Kosha to Hiranmaya Kosha, this 5 kosha. And Kamamaya Kosha is the Muladhara, the seat of controller of solid factor. And here there are 4 vittis. 4 vittis means a propensity. Then Manamaya Kosha is at the Swadhisthana Chakra, the controller of a liquid factor. And here we have 3 vittis, 6 propensities. And then Atimanas Kosha is at the Manipur or controller of a luminous factor and has 6 vittis, propensities, 10 vittis. And Vigyanamaya Kosha is at the Anahat and controller of aerial factor and has 12 vittis, 12 propensities. And Hiranmaya Kosha is the Vishuddha Chakra and controller of ethereal factor and has 16 vittis. So these are 48 vittis. And Ajna Chakra, there are 2 vittis and seat of mind, nucleus lunar factors. All the chakras are controlled from Sahasrara Chakra. So we have these 50 vittis as per Baba's explanation. The 50 vittis work internal and external. So 50 into 2 is 100. Then in 10 direction, 100 into 10 is 1,000. So Sahasrara Chakra is 1,000 petal, lotus is there. Sadhana is to purify all the koshas and lower kosha is purified. As the lower kosha is purified, the next upper koshas take the lead in this way. We can go ahead up to Hiranmaya Kosha. And as we process in the sadhana, as we go from as you have seen that from Muladhara to upper chakra, to Swadhisthana Chakra, Hiranmaya Kosha, all these 50 vittis are slowly controlled. So one by one chakra, and as sadhana is progressing, so finally Hiranmaya Kosha is taking the lead. And then we go more higher, and above Hiranmaya Kosha is this Samanya Deha, which need to be merged into cosmic entity for complete liberation. At the merger, finally, in the Satya Loka, the seat of non-attribution entity takes place. The first, the physical body should be purified by sentient food and asana. Second, kamamay kosh must be purified by jama niyama. Third, manamay kosh must be purified by pratyahara. And fourth, adimay kosh must be purified by pranayama. And fifth, vijnanamay kosh must be purified by dharana. And sixth, hiranamay kosh must be purified by dhyana. So this is, you see, asana, then jama niyama, then pratyahara, then pranayama, then dharana and dhyan, then finally we have to merge in him, that is called samadhi. So eightfold of sadhana. Next slide. Then we get samadhi last up, and this is what is that lesson. Many people ask, what is that lesson? We have come up to dhyana, then samadhi. For samadhi, what is this lesson? Those who have taken the dhyan lesson, they know that last part of dhyan lesson is margin in him. That margin is the samadhi part. So when we do dhyan, we have to very, very cautiously do the dhyana, and the last stage where we margin him, that should be performed very, very meticulously. And you know, one thing I want to explain here, that we do dhyana in our Guru Chakra, and there we visualize this Taraka Bhamma, that Guru, we visualize him, and we merge in him. Even I will not go into details of that one. We merge in one point in him, and that point is above the Guru Chakra, that is in Sahasrara Chakra. So that part has to be remembered, that we are finally merging ourselves in the Sahasrara Chakra, that is the seat of Nirguna Bhamma. Ajna Chakra does not directly control any fundamental factor, but by its spiritual power, control the psychic force, chitta vitti. A part of mind remains intimately associated with the prana that controls all the chakras. More the sadhaka progress on the path of sadhana, the more their chakras and propensity are gradually controlled by the higher and higher process. You are seeing, as we are going higher and higher, the 4 bhittis, 6 bhittis, 10 bhittis, then 12 and 16. All the bhittis are generally just slowly controlled by ourselves. And this one kosha, the higher kosha is taking the lead. The kosha control the chakra and propensity which belong to them, and with the help of crude nerves. The greater the control we achieve over the kosha through our sadhana, the more the indriya, the organ, will become submissive in us. And also the propensity will also be controlled by us. When the people's internal thought and knowledge go on developing as they become established in their higher kosha due to their control over mind and indriyas, organs, they will be unaffected by external influences. All their vanity, inertness, and superstition rapidly disappear. The impact of external object leads to psychic perversion, whereas impact of subtle internal idea due to introspection manifests a synthetic mind in the intuition. This is called pragya manas. In the final stage, the intuitional mind, that is pragya manas, the abode of sankalpa and vikalpa, free from psychic bearing, ultimately transforms itself into cognitive bearing, pragya sarupatta. This is partial happiness when each chakra is perfected. So long as the soul is not attained, every kosha has to be perfected. So we get partial happiness when one chakra is perfected. But when all the chakras are perfected, then we got the final happiness. One kosha cannot be perfected to the exclusion of race. All kosha needs to be perfect. This is tantra sadhana. But the sadhaka must not stop there. At the final stage of sadhana, even the stance, bhava of ajna chakra and their entire mind entity has to be taken to a higher state of existence, the brahma loka or the satya loka, and merge in purusha bhava or cognitive bearing. It is a sahasra chakra, pineal flexes. The sadhaka establish themselves in the true blissful state and transcend the bondage of pleasure and pain. There exists neither he, I, or he. the two becomes one. It is by means of Eightfold Sadhana, Ashtanga Yoga, that this supreme rank is attainable. The destiny of human being is in their own hand, because we have to do all these things, and we need love for the goal and stamina. These two things are needed, and that is supplied by our sadhana. We are certainly capable of controlling ourselves in our propensity, the demons in us. The various activities of Ashtanga Yoga sadhana, as I have told, this asana, jamniyam, pattahara, panayam, dhyana, dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. We do dhyana in Guru Chakra. Guru Chakra is just below Sahasrara Chakra. We visualize Guru there. He is Taraka Brahma, the bridge between Saguna and Nirguna. This Taraka Brahma is a concept in Tantra. He is the bridge between Saguna and Nirguna, attribution and non-attributional entity. In the final stage of Dhyana, we merge in him. The point where we merge is the Guru Chakra, above Guru Chakra, that is Sahasrara Chakra. Remember last part of Dhyana lesson. The margin in Nirguna Brahma, non-attribution entity, we have to take the help of Tarak Brahma, that is Guru, a concept of Tantra Guru. Without the help of Guru, we can't merge in Nirguna Brahma. So this Tarak Brahma, help of Tarak Brahma in the form of Guru is must for a tantric practice, for a sadhana. So grace of Guru is must for final merger. Our whole practice are based on Tantra. This Sahaj Yoga, Vishesh Yoga, Kapalik Sadhana, all lesson from Sahaja Yoga to Kapali. More emphasis is given to different type of Panayama and Dhyana. In Kapalik Sadhana, one parameter is more, that is victory over fear, shame, and hatred are systematically achieved. But no yoga is less important. Baba himself has guaranteed liberation in his supreme command. Side by side, Kirtana, Kausaki, and Kadamba helps in our sadhana. Service to the suffering humanity is also a part of sadhana. So these all, everything are included in Tantra. And we should not leave one and adhere to others. So everything has to be continued. Baba has given this Kirtana, Baba Nam Kevala. It is eight syllable, Baba Nam Kevalam. Why eight syllable? Because in us there are eight chakra, and this Sahasrara Chakra is nine chakra. So this eight syllable, with this eight syllable Baba Nam Kevalam, we can go up to this Guru Chakra by doing Kirtana, and then this from Guru Chakra, that our mind jumped to the Sahasrara Chakra, and finally we attain him. So Kirtana is also very important in our process of this sadhana, and this all Kausaki, Tandava, and service to the humanity, all this help us. Service to the humanity, what suffering humanity, what happened? Here our mind is purified, and when mind is purified, we concentrate more on sadhana, our concentration increases in sadhana. So all this help in our sadhana, whatever helps in our sadhana is a part of this tantra. So we should not leave anything aside and do other thing. So side by side, we should do everything in our sadhana, this Ashtanga Yoga sadhana, we should continue. And side by side, do Kirtana, Kausaki, Tandava, service, everything should be included in our sadhana. And like that, finally we merge in him. That is the final goal.
Thank you, Dada. That was very inspirational.
Thank you. Oscar, I think I have not taken more time.
No, everybody takes more time in our programs. It's required.
I've started from the initially and how finally we merge in him, how sadhana help. This is all tantric practices. And never think that this Sahaj Yoga will not help us, or Vishesh Yoga will help. Other lessons are some complicated, like some more panayans and more dhyanas are there. Otherwise, there is nothing, no more difference. You have to have love for him and have to have stamina to attain that goal.
There was one question in the chat, Dada, maybe if you could address it. Let's see. Oh, what are the changes Baba made from Shiva Tantra and other tantras like Kashmiri Tantra?
Really, what happened, this tantra had been given by Lord Shiva. And at that time, there was a system that nothing should be written down. It should go from guru to disciple and from disciple to next disciple like that. So in the course of time, many things were lost and many other things which are not essential in tantra has been included in that. And there were a lot of confusion. Baba made everything systematic. And that all these Ashtangic yoga, sadhana, Baba made them systematic how we should do sadhana. That is the main, whatever I've seen, that is the main contribution of Baba in respect to Tantra. Everything was lost. And there was more garbage in the Tantra than real thing. So if you talk about other Tantra and like that, that needs one more sitting and like that. I have to compare all these Tantra.
Okay, thank you, Dada. One person was asking, let's see. Okay, no, it's just a welcome to you.
I think Baba gave this old wine in a new bottle. No, it is not like that. Baba included also some, like we do third lesson, the chakra, chakra shuddhi, that was not there. Vishesh yoga also. So whatever is needed for the society, the peasant situation and like that, Baba has included those things in the sadhana for everybody. So Baba always, previously there was a system that this will be not taught to others. Only selected people will be getting the sadhana. That Baba broke that system. Baba told that, see, good thing has to be given to everybody and bad thing should be discouraged. So why good thing, people should not get the good thing. So that was Baba's main. Yeah, there is one question, is there any tantra in the Vedas? Vedas, there are more thing and these ritual things are there in Vedas. Those people who were following Vedas system and like that, they knew that without the Tantra Sadhana, they will not attain anything final, they will not attain. So in the daytime, they were doing all these Vedas and like, and in the night times, secretly, they were going to the burial ground and like that, practicing the Tantra Sadhana that Baba has told in many, many places. This, you know, though Patik is a jantra, here somebody has question, that is a part of Tantra Sadhana, Tantra Sadhana and the Kapali Sadhana. I can't go details into that one. Somebody has question about Vishesh Yoga. Some people think that it should be taught to one. You see, even you see Dhyan lesson, what we learn, without practicing nicely the dharana, we can't practice nice this Dhyan lesson. Dharana, we must get hold of this dharana lesson, then we can do Dhyan lesson nicely. So once you see this Vishesh Yoga is mostly about formless sadhana. So unless you have control, you have done a lot of things, thinking about this all form, Baba and like this, and your mind is going up from to formless, then only Vishesh Yoga can be beneficial. So Baba was selecting very few people on his will. I don't know what was the criteria he was telling yes or no, but very less number of person he was giving. And that Vishesh Yoga, you need at least 6 hour time in a day, 3 hours in the morning, 3 hours in the evening to practice it. So most of the people will not get that time, only taking Vishesh Yoga. For Vishesh Yoga, I am Vishesh Yoga practitioner is not sufficient.
When you speak of transformation of the individual's force into Vairavi Shakti, what is the force to which you refer? Jeeva Shakti, Kundalini, Prana, which one?
This is generally the force in us. This is, if you ask like this, Jeeva Shakti, Kundalini or Prana, that is spiritual force in us. That is to be converted into this Bhavani to Bhairavi and then to Kaushiki. The spiritual force are in us.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dada. I wish we had more time. As you can see, Dada is very accessible. Hopefully, you know, anyone, when everything's clear up in India, people can visit him, and we'll try to bring him through the computer to us some more in the future. And thank you.
I can give the PPT presentation. Some few corrections are needed. Sometimes it happens like that. My eyesight is something suffering. So one or two place I have to do a few corrections, and then I'll send it to you. And if somebody needs, they can go through that.
Okay, that's great. Okay, thank you so much, Dada.
I send this for translation into other language, but I thought, let me first present it, then I'll send it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.